Welcome to 700 Club Interactive. Well, China has been no stranger to controversial headlines, from the rise of communism to the one-child policy. Well, our guest today is no stranger to these issues. She was a student leader during the Tian'anmen Square protest who dared to stand up. Take a look.
So my story started with the beginning of the end of the last emperor and eventually lead to what had happened in 1989, what kind of forces pushed me and my other fellow student walk into the square to demonstrate for our democratic society.
The student at Tian'anmen Square waited until 6 a.m. in the morning with the hope that the United States would come in to intervene. They did it. I could not believe a peaceful moment, a moment of love and care and nonviolence this time are being encountered faced with the brutal tanks and troops. Death no longer a theory, an academic discussion. It's real. It's moving towards us step by step. Afterwards, I was put on the most wanted list, and I had to escape from China as we were put into a cargo box. And the journey was supposed to be only 8 hours, but it ended up taking much longer. I knelt down in the corner of my office and invited Lord to my heart to guide my life and to forgive all my sins. So now I'm afraid.
Well, please welcome to 700 Club Interactive, entrepreneur, social activist, and Christian, Chai Ling. Chai, welcome to the 700 Club.
Oh, thank you so much, Gordon. I'm just so honored to be on your show, and you're my hero. Thank you for you and your family have done for this amazing country, for the world. Thank you.
Well, thank you. Thank you. A lot of Americans have a lot of conceptions, if you will, on Tian'anmen Square and what exactly happened in June 1989. Some call it a pro-democracy movement. Some call it a revolution. But from your standpoint, it was really neither one of those. It was a lot of students asking a very simple question, why? Tell us about it.
Yeah, it turned out to be the biggest spiritual awakening in history on Earth. And we are young students brought up in the communism system. We believed in it. We thought we can go to the square and ask for the government to reform, then we can have a better communism. We will live happily ever after. So at the beginning, we experienced this amazing power of peace and love and joy. People just came out from all their shells, the hatred, disbelief, and betrayal, and to break down and to really embrace each other. It was the most beautiful time in Tian'anmen. And then, you know, even the thieves have decided to go on strike, that they would stop stealing because they want to support the student movement. But then, of course, on the night of June 3rd and June 4th morning, it turned to the worst, the hell on earth, when the tanks and troops moved in, killed people randomly, including nurses, and tried to rescue people. God used the evil for good. And 20 years later, it brought over 10% of the Chinese population, which is about 125, 130 million people into his kingdom.
Yeah, you're not the first person I've talked to that credited Tian'anmen Square with the current revival that's going on in China. And it's a very peaceful one at the same time, that there's this fundamental change happening. Where do you see China going? A lot of people are saying it's the century for China, that China is going to become the most powerful nation on the planet, probably within a decade. It might take two decades. At the same time, some people caution, well, they still haven't had democracy. There's still issues with freedom of thought, freedom of expression. Where do you see China going?
If we fail to transform China into fundamentally Christian nation, we're going to see a China to be a very nasty China, militant, have so much money and power concentrated in a few, you know, ones who does not fear God nor love people or value human lives. And so each year there are between 16 million to 23 million forced and coerced abortions are taking place. 500 women commit suicides, and for every six baby girls are scheduled to be born, the number six girl would never make it. And for, you know, the family would chose to, you know, abort the baby or abandon the baby right after birth to make room for the boy. And so the number six boy were grown up, not able to find a wife. So by now, today, China has over 37 million single men that do not have wife.
I think a lot of our viewers don't understand. Why in Chinese culture is it so important to have a boy?
The man will marry the woman to come in to their household. So if on a way, you know, imagine we a family can only have one child, by the time they finish raising that one girl, they will lose the girl. And because China does not have a social security system, so the parents would grow old, have no one to take care of them. So many families, agricultural family, need man labor to mine the field. They tend to prefer the son over the girls. We discovered in one city in China where they have 3 million populations, up to 600,000 of those populations are a result of child trafficking or child bride trafficking.
We've got a question for you coming in from our chat room. Kim is asking on chat, how does the Chinese government enforce the one child policy? Do they how do they know a woman is pregnant?
Oh, it's a great, excellent question. Thank you for asking. So the Chinese government enforced this policy very brutally. On September 22nd, we had a congressional hearing. Congressman Christmas has been fighting this battle for almost 30 years. He's such a hero and such a godly man. So one of the, there were two witnesses in addition to me. One witness had five forced abortions. She was a factory worker. There, they have this family planning police lady who monitored everybody's pregnancy situation every month. So every month, these workers had to go female workers had to go hand off their menstrual period pad to prove that they were not pregnant. If they are late to show that pad, or if they late for the exam, the family police would just come pump that person, haul that person over to a clinic to be examined. So they also, because China was a planned economy, so they tied up everybody's compensation into the result of this implementation of this policy. If one worker in that unit is found out to have out-of-planned pregnancy, that entire unit will lose its bonus. So as a result of that, they make everybody watch each other. So among five of her forced abortions, two of them result of handover pulled by her co-workers. So when this woman was going through a forced abortion, that was early stage forced abortions. She was hauled in five times and performing those abortions with no anesthesia. There was a second witness, she went through two forced abortions. The second time the forced abortion, they basically, because she was fighting so hard, they dragged her down from the four floor down building into this forced abortion clinics, and they sedated her completely, and they implement IUD right after the abortion procedure. And when her family realized she could no longer be available to deliver a son for them, and they just divorced her. So that's another, so the women are suffering both the forced abortion and also gendercide in China. So when I testify in Congress, I, shared my own coerced abortion experience. I was, unmarried at that time, so I was not qualified to get a birth permit. And so I had three pregnancies, during that time. And that was even worse because the entire culture is really condemning against young women who got pregnant before marriage. The first couple of times was my father or my girlfriend, my boyfriend's father took me in the forced abortion clinics. And again, the early stage was no anesthesia. For the women who were pregnant, in the later stage, there was another witness who testified, I think 2009 November here, and her name was Wu Jian, and she was 5 months pregnant, and she was hauled out from her hiding place, and was dumped with another 100 women who was, being schedule going through this procedure, and they stick this long needle into her tummy and into the baby's skull and inject poison and they kill the baby inside the womb and, you know, let the contraction take place to either push the baby out. And for her, in her situation, her baby did not come out. So, you know, they had to open her body up and cut the baby in pieces to take them out.
Well, Chai Ling, thank you. You're one of my heroes for being so public and so open about this incredible issue. I think a lot of people in America really do not understand the current situation in China, particularly on how the one-child policy is enforced. If you want more information on Chai Ling, she's got a nonprofit. It's called All Girls Allowed, trying to bring this issue to the forefront, not just in America, but also around the world, to make people aware of exactly what's going on in China. She also has a book out called A Heart for Freedom, her journey of faith and awakening, both from Tian'anmen Square, how she became a Christian, and her quest to free China's daughters. If you want that, it's available at bookstores nationwide. Chai Ling, thank you for being with us.
Yeah, thank you so much, Gordon. God bless you and all your ministry.
Thank you. God bless you. Well, when we come back, a look at population control in China and how it's affecting young men right after this.
People are connecting every day on Facebook and Twitter. Now you can connect on topics you care about through 700 Club Interactive. Log on to Facebook or go to Twitter and share your opinions, your prayer requests, and make friends in our community.
Welcome to 700 Club Interactive.
Be a part of the show on Facebook and Twitter. 700 Club Interactive.
Well, decades after starting its controversial one-child policy, China now has a unique problem, a shortage of brides, and millions of men cannot find wives. Some desperate families even rely on human traffickers to find their sons a bride. George Thomas has more from Beijing.
www.95195.com. It's one of Beijing's fastest growing dating companies.
I'm here with my mother to look for a wife.
On a recent Friday afternoon, 21-year-old Cheng Niyong left work early to visit the offices of 95195. Inside, wall-to-wall pictures of women also looking for a spouse.
I never considered doing it this way, but this is how many people nowadays are looking for a soulmate.
And after filling out a few personal details, getting his picture taken, and paying a small registration fee, his profile will soon hang on the walls among the hundreds of other men, hoping to catch the eye of some lucky lady.
We have a good success rate matching potential couples, but the truth is that it is very difficult for men to find a woman. The competition for spouses is tough.
And here's why. There are 122 baby boys born each year in China for every 100 girls. The normal ratio is 105 boys born for every 100 girls. And the gender ratio is only getting worse. Chinese government figures show by 2020, there will be close to 40 million more men 19 years and younger than women. That's more than Canada's entire population.
I worry about this, and so do many of my male friends who are in the same boat.
The problem started in 1980 when China launched its controversial one-child policy. The aim, you see, back then was to limit births to one child per couple and keep the country's population below 1.2 billion. The government claims the policy has prevented 400 million births.
But the consequences of this social experiment have touched every Chinese household.
The centuries-old preference for boys, coupled with the millions of aborted female fetuses, puts China at the top of countries where boys outnumber girls. Those fortunate enough to find love insist changes must be made.
If not, the long-term implications are going to be devastating.
Even the government is beginning to realize that this is a huge problem. In fact, a couple of years ago, China's State Population Commission said the following: the increasingly difficulties men face finding wives may lead to social instability.
In some parts of rural China, there are villages that literally have no women. Families become desperate, So thousands of women are kidnapped and trafficked into China each year, and many sold to families whose sons cannot find brides.
This is a very serious problem and one of many unintended consequences of the one-child policy.
And the latest census numbers reveal another unintended consequence, China's aging population. The over 60s make up just over 13% of the country. That's up nearly 3% from 2000. And those over 65 account for nearly 9% compared with 7% 10 years ago. Meanwhile, people under 14 are now less than 17% of the country. That's down from 23% a decade ago. Analysts worry a graying China could shrink the labor force and slow the nation's economic growth. Goldman Sachs says the potential for China getting older before getting rich is very real.
We're facing the problem of an aging population. It was more pronounced in coastal areas and in the more developed regions with large populations.
The census figures, growing gender imbalance, and bride shortages have some calling for China to move to a two-child policy.
People must have the opportunity to have more children if they choose to.
But China's leaders aren't convinced, vowing in late April to maintain the status quo. Back at 95195.com's office in Beijing, Chang Niyong is still looking through the pictures. No one has caught his attention today, but he says he'll keep trying until he finds someone or someone finds him.
It might take a while, but I'm willing to wait.
George Thomas, CBN News, Beijing.
There is a big problem here, and if you ever talk to some of the other Southeast Asian countries about the China one-child policy, their actually greatest fear is that China will launch a war just to try to find brides. It'll be that kind of situation, social upheaval. Just imagine, 40 million single men, and what does that mean? And where do you go with that? You know, how do you grow? How do you grow your economy? And then this is going to be a serious issue for them, and the demographics are quickly taking over. Well, coming up, an abandoned baby is in the miracle a couple long for, right after this.
I just don't know what to do.
Being a foster or adoptive parent can be very difficult. I know, I've been there. That's why Orphans Promise developed Adoption and Foster RX, Solutions for Wounded Families. In this DVD series, parenting experts take on the tough issues and offer proven strategies. Don't miss this vital information. Call now, because there is hope for wounded families.
We ask CBN.com users how we could make our website easier to use, and we listen.
This is really easy to read and move through.
The information opens up a whole lot quicker.
Yeah, it's much faster.
There's everything I'm interested in right here, the click of a mouse.
The new CBN.com has been redesigned, making it faster to find your favorite 700 Club stories, musical guests, our online community, and special features.
Anyone can enjoy this new site.
Visit the new CBN.com today.
Chinese laws prevent many families from having more than one child, so children born with defects are often unwanted or even abandoned and left to die.
For 20 years, Mr. and Mrs. Wen wanted to have a baby. They tried everything their doctor suggested, but were never able to conceive.
I was so sad, especially when I saw other parents with their children. But my husband and I prayed about it for a long time and decided that maybe God had a different plan for us.
Then one day, Mr. Wen heard crying coming from a box on the side of the road. As he got closer, he could see that someone had abandoned a baby. When he looked inside the box, he knew why. The baby girl had a cleft lip. Mr. Wen took her home and named her Jia Lin, which means beautiful jade. The Wens wondered if this was God's answer to their prayers.
I fell in love with Jia Ling the minute I saw her. And I knew that if my wife and I did not take care of her, she would die. We did not have any idea what to do about Jia Ling's cleft lip, but we were going to try our best to save her.
The Wens found out that the surgery their daughter needed would cost $1,300. Mr. Wen works in construction and only makes $150 a month. So the couple wasn't sure how they could ever pay for surgery. Then a neighbor told them that CBN had helped his son, who had also been born with a cleft lip.
I did not know whether or not CBN would be able to help us too, but I just prayed that God would have compassion on us. Then I called CBN.
CBN arranged free cleft lip surgery for Jia Lin that completely transformed her face and her future. Today she is perfectly healthy and can eat, smile, and laugh just like other baby girls.
We thank God for hearing our prayers and sending CBN to help our little Jia Lin.
I never thought there could be someone that really cared about what we were going through. But you did. You showed us God's great love. Thank you for saving Jia Lin. Now, she will have a beautiful life.
You can be part of making beautiful lives, not just in China, but around the world. We want to reach out and love people. We're not here to judge. We're not here to condemn. We're here to bring the love of Jesus Christ, to let people know that they can trust God. You can rely on Him. You can rely on His mercy. It endures forever. You can rely on His faithfulness. You can rely on Him. He can solve every human need if we just trust Him. If you want to be a part of what we're doing around the world, how we're reaching out to abandoned babies in China, how we're reaching out with fresh water wells for the villages of India, how we're bringing medical missions to the Philippines, to Indonesia, how we're doing livelihood programs in Africa, how we're helping people in Central and South America. If you want to be a part of all of it, all you have to do is join the 700 Club. A portion of each gift goes into the work of Operation Blessing to help people in very tangible ways. Another portion goes into the work of CBN International to preach the gospel around the world. So if you want to be a part of it, join with us. How much is it? Well, it's just $20 a month. That's just 65 cents a day. So call us, 888-777-1999, or you can log on to CBN.com. When you call, ask for Pledge Express. That's electronic monthly giving. The bank does all the work. So there's no checks to write, nothing to mail in, and we save so much on the processing we can send as our gift back to you. Power for Life, monthly teaching CDs. If you want it, ask for Pledge Express. Well, we've got time to take a prayer call. Here's Sharon from South Carolina. Hi, Sharon.
Hi, Gordon.
How can we pray for you?
Could you pray for me? I'm just asking for healing in my body, mostly my female organs, and that God will give me strength and health and strength to be here to take care of my special need daughter, who is 23 years old, who totally depend on me.
Okay. Have you found a lump?
I think I did. I haven't been diagnosed yet, but I think I found one, but I don't want to claim anything.
Okay.
And I want to know, how do I know that God answers prayers? When I pray to Him, how do I know He hears me?
You know that He hears you. When we pray with this confidence, When we pray according to His will, this is what the Apostle John wrote, when we pray according to His will, we know that He hears us. And if He hears us, we know that we have the requests that we make in prayer. We know these things. Now, Sharon, is there anything separating you from God?
I don't have any hate in my heart, but I was in a, honestly and truly, I was in an adulterous relationship, but I'm not in a relationship. I do communicate, but no sexual contact is going on.
Is he married?
Yes.
Okay. Does it bother you that you're doing that?
That I'm conversating on the phone talking?
Yeah.
No, sir. As long as I don't pull off my clothes and go to bed with him, no.
Okay. You think his wife would like that?
No, honestly, truly, even though we talk about God and we pray for people, no, sir.
Okay. Well, you can put a Christian veneer on something, but if you don't think that this is something you want to go public with, you might want to stop it. If our conscience doesn't condemn us is another thing that the Apostle John put in, his sort of outline for prayer. that if our conscience doesn't condemn us, then we can go boldly to the throne of grace. Now, I really like that you put the sexual things behind you. That's good. But one of the things about maintaining emotional relationships is, you could get into a dangerous ground here. There's an old saying that, you know, if you hang out in the barber shop, you're going to get your hair cut.
Okay, thank you.
So, you know, you may want to just say, okay, to this guy, I'll see you in heaven. And we can talk for all eternity.
Okay, I don't want nothing to separate me. I want God to let me live, to take care of my baby here on earth. But when I do leave this world and I ask him to let me live to get 89 or 100, I do want to go to heaven. And there ain't no one down here on this earth that I want to separate that.
Okay, that's good. All right, so if we confess our sins, he is faithful and just to forgive us and cleanse us from all unrighteousness. And Jesus has this word for you, Sharon. There is no sin that cannot be forgiven.
Okay.
And what he said to the adulterous woman, he is saying today, go and sin no more. I don't condemn you. Go and sin no more.
Okay.
And so with that, you're free. He holds nothing against you. The amazing thing is God loves us. He keeps no records of wrongs. He holds nothing against you, Sharon. And so you can go boldly to the throne of grace. Now, faith is an act, and praying in accordance with God's will is an act. So if the Apostle John says if we pray in accordance with his will, then we know that he hears us. And if he hears us, we know that we have the thing that we're asking for. So with that, here's a wonderful verse for you. He forgives all our iniquities. He heals all our diseases.
Okay.
You can find that in Psalms. He forgives all our iniquities. He heals all our diseases. So now we know the will of God.
Yes.
The will of God is to forgive Sharon. The will of God is to heal Sharon.
Thank you, Jesus.
So we're going to pray in accordance with that will. And we know this even from the words of Jesus, where he says, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. So in heaven, is there anybody guilty? No. In heaven, is there anybody sick? No. Is there anybody fearful of death? No. So that's God's will. And Jesus commanded us, pray this, that his will would be done on earth as it is in heaven. And so right now we're going to pray that his will would be done in Sharon's body. And right, in an act of faith, Sharon, just lay your hand where you found that lump. And we're going to agree, and God's going to take care of it for you.
Thank you, Jesus.
Lord, in Jesus' name, we come in agreement with Sharon. And as she is acting in faith, laying her hand on that area that needs healing, we come into agreement with her, and we say, be dissolved and be gone. And we break off of her the fear of death.
Thank you.
And we say to her, you shall not die, but live.
Thank you, God.
And declare the glory of the Lord. And so we declare life over her. An abundant life. You came that Sharon might have life and have it abundantly. And she will be able to care for her daughter. And everything will be made right.
Thank you, God.
For Sharon. And Lord, we also pray for her daughter, and we just ask for healing for her. We ask for restoration. We ask for others to come alongside to help Sharon and be with her and to lighten her load. And we just ask for a community of believers to surround her with love and let her know that she's accepted and she's loved for who she is. We speak peace to Sharon, the peace that passes all understanding.
Thank you, God.
In Jesus' name.
In Jesus' name.
Amen.
Amen. Thank you. I had a fear in my stomach before I called you, and now it's not there. Thank you, Jesus.
Thank you. Thank you for calling, Sharon. God bless you.
Bye-bye.
We'll leave you this word from Isaiah 58. The Lord will guide you continually, giving you water when you are dry and restoring your strength. God bless you.